Hello students, in today class we will discuss about the atropine. In this class we will discuss about the source of atropine, isolation method, identification test, industrial production of atropine, its estimation and utilizations of atropine. So now atropine, this term has been derived from the Greek word atropos, which is the goddess of death, who determined when a person would die. And atropine was firstly isolated from the roots of Atropa belladonna by the German medical practitioners when in 1831, and it is a tropane alkaloid which is normally found in the leaves and flowering tops of the plants belonging to family Solanaceae, for example Atropa belladonna, which is commonly known as the deadly nightshade, thorn apple, which is the leaves of Datura stramonium, then Datura metals, and Hyoscyamus niger, which is known as the henbane. Okay, so it is the introduction part of atropine, and you have to remember that the atropine terms has been derived from the Greek word, that is atropos. Atropos is the goddess of death, and this atropine has been isolated firstly from the roots of the Atropa belladonna by the German apothecary when in 1831, and basically it is the tropane alkaloids which is normally obtained from the leaves and flowering tops of the plants of Solanaceae family, and examples of Solanaceae family plants are Atropa belladonna, Datura metals, and Datura stramoniums, and Hyoscyamus niger. And if you see the characteristics of atropine, so it is the basically the racemic mixtures of D-hyoscyamine and L-hyoscyamine. Okay, it is the racemic mixtures of D-hyoscyamine and L-hyoscyamine. D means dextroforms and L for levoforms. So it is the racemic mixtures of D-hyoscyamine and L-hyoscyamine, and most of the physiological activity of atropine is because of the L-hyoscyamine. So this L-hyoscyamine is responsible for the physiological effect, or we can say for the pharmacological activities. So it all activities are because of the L-hyoscyamine. And if you see the molecular formula of atropine, it is C17H23NO3, and it's occur in the form of white crystals or in crystalline powder form, and color will be white in color. It is odorless and has the bitter taste. Melting point is 114 to 116 degrees Celsius, whereas its boiling point is 393 degrees Celsius. And atropine is insoluble in the polar solvent and highly soluble in the non-polar solvent like chloroform. Whereas in case of salt of atropine, it is just opposite. The salt of atropine are soluble in the polar solvent, whereas insoluble in the non-polar solvent. So for the extractions and isolations, this characteristics is the basic for their isolation purpose. According to their solubility pattern, we can select the solvent to extract or isolate this phytoconstituent. So you always remember that atropine is insoluble in polar solvent. It is insoluble in polar solvent and highly soluble in the non-polar solvent. Okay, it means when it is in the form of atropine, when we are using the term atropine, it means it's occur in the free base form. So it is in the free base form, it will be insoluble in the polar solvent, whereas highly soluble in the non-polar solvent. Whereas if this free base is converted into the salt form, then it will be just opposite. So the salt of atropine will be soluble in the polar solvent and insoluble in the non-polar solvent. So now the isolation method. So the basic principle of extraction is based on that pure base can be convert to salt by treating with the mineral acid. So if the drug is in the form of free base, that can be converted into the salt form by treating with the acid, whereas alkaloidal salt can be convert into the pure base after treating with the alkali. So this is the basic principle for the isolation or extractions of the atropine. Normally Datura stramonium and Hyoscyamus muticus, okay, Datura stramonium and Hyoscyamus muticus are preferred for the manufacturing of atropine because of the higher content of atropine is present in these plants, Datura stramonium and Hyoscyamus muticus. Okay, now there are so many methods for the isolation, or we can say for the extraction of the atropine. So first method is that in this method we will collect the plant drug, and we will convert the after drying the plant material, we will convert it into the powder form. That coarse powder is moist with the 10% of aqueous sodium carbonate solution for 4 to 6 hours, due to which it forms the dumpy mass. Okay, what we are doing, that first of all we have to collect the leaf material or flowering top of the plant, of the selected plant. Then we have to dry it. After completion of drying, we have to convert this plant material into the coarse powder form. Then we will moist this powder drug with the 10% aqueous sodium carbonate solution and for at least for 4 to 6 hours to form the create dump mass. Now this mass is subjected to extractions with the non-polar solvent, that may be ether or benzene. Okay, so what is the principle is going there, that now we are treating with the non-polar solvent. It means at this stage it is in the form of the free base, as we say that atropine is insoluble in the polar solvent and highly soluble in the non-polar solvent. So ether and benzenes are the non-polar solvent. So we are taking these non-polar solvent for the extractions of the atropine, and at this stage it is in the free base form. That's why it is soluble in the non-polar solvent, and these non-polar solvent, ether or benzenes, we are using. Now after extractions, this non-polar solvent should be evaporated with the help of distillations under reduced pressure, followed by the extractions with the एसिटिक एसिड, और वी कैन से ट्रीटमेंट विद द एसिटिक एसिड. तो हम यहाँ पे कर क्या रहे हैं कि हमने सबसे पहले प्लांट मटेरियल कलेक्ट किया, उसके लीफ या फ्लावर टॉप आपके कुछ भी हैं वो आपने कलेक्ट किया, उसके बाद आप इसको ड्राइंग करेंगे. ड्राई करने के बाद आप इसका मॉइस्ट करते हैं 10% एक्वस सोडियम कार्बोनेट सॉल्यूशन के साथ, जिसकी वजह से इसका क्या है, एक डंपी मास बन जाएगा. डंपी मास को अब आप क्या करेंगे, एक्सट्रैक्ट करेंगे नॉन पोलर सॉल्वेंट के साथ. तो सॉल्वेंट आप जो यूज कर सकते हैं वो ईथर भी हो सकता है, बेंजीन भी हो सकता है, जो कि आपके नॉन पोलर सॉल्वेंट है. नॉन पोलर सॉल्वेंट हम क्यों यूज कर रहे हैं, क्योंकि एट दिस स्टेज, फ्री स्टेज में ये यहाँ पर आपका काफ़ी सॉल्युबल होता है, जिसके लिए हम ईथर या बेंजीन हम यूज़ कर रहे हैं. अब जब आप इसको कंप्लीट एक्सट्रैक्शंस करेंगे, वट एवर योर ऑफिशियल प्रोसीजर, जो टाइम पीरियड उसमें लिखा होगा, जहाँ से आप लिटरेचर को फॉलो करते हुए इस मेथड को अडॉप्ट करेंगे, उसमें जो टाइम सफिशेंट लिखा है वो आप पूरा होने के बाद इसको आप फिल्टर कर लेते हैं, और नॉन पोलर सॉल्वेंट को फिल्ट्रेट से आप इवेपोरेट कर देंगे, ठीक है, विद द हेल्प ऑफ द डिस्टिलेशन अंडर रिड्यूस्ड प्रेशर. और उसके बाद जो रेसिड्यू बचता है आपका, उस रेसिड्यू को आप ट्रीट करते हैं विद द एसिटिक एसिड. नाउ दिस एक्वस एसिटिक फ्रैक्शन शुड बी पार्टीशन विद द सॉल्वेंट ईथर टू रिमूव द कलरिंग मैटर. ओके, नाउ वट इज गोइंग देयर, दैट आफ्टर ट्रीटमेंट विद द एसिटिक acid we will get the aqueous acidic fractions. So we will extract this aqueous acidic fractions with the solvent ether. Now there will be the two separate layers will be there, and in ether layer all the coloring matter and resinous matters will go in the ether layer, and aqueous acidic fractions will be the other phase, and this process is carried out with the help of the separating funnel. Now, aqueous acidic fraction is made alkaline with sodium carbonate due to which free base precipitates. अब क्या हुआ आपका कि इसके बाद जब आपने ईथर के साथ सेपरेटिंग फनल में इसको सेपरेट कर दिया, ईथर लेयर में आपकी जितनी इम्प्यूरिटीज़ हैं, आइदर वो आपके कलरिंग मैटर्स है और चाहे आपका रेजिनियस कंटेंट है, उसके बाद जो आपका ये एक्वस एसिडिक फ्रैक्शन बचा है इसको हम अल्कलाइन बनाते हैं विद द हेल्प ऑफ द सोडियम कार्बोनेट ड्यू टू विच फ्री बेस प्रेसिपिटेटेड. नाउ दीज प्रेसिपिटेट्स शुड बी फिल्टर्ड ऑफ फॉलोड बाय द ड्राइंग. Now, this dried material should be treated with the solvent ether or acetone followed by the filtrations. Now, again we are extracting this precipitate with the ether or acetone because these are the non-polar solvent, and after treating with the alkaline, it is again in the free base form. It is basic in nature, so it will be soluble in the ether or acetone followed by the filtration. Now what you will do, that you have to extract with the solvent ether or acetone, then after completion of extraction you will filter the solution, then filtrate should be evaporate under the reduced pressure, so due to which crystals of atropine and hyoscyamines are obtained. Now, after collections of the crystals, they should be treated with the alcohol and sodium hydroxide, due to which hyoscyamine is racemized into the atropine. So, this it is the first method for the extractions of the atropine. And in another method, we have to take the dried powder material, we will extract with the solvent alcohol. Here we are taking the polar solvent alcohol followed by the filtration. Okay, what you have to do, that you have to take the plant material, dried that plant material, convert into the coarse powder form, then this coarse powder will be extracted with the alcohol followed by the filtration. And after filtrations, whatever the solvent is there in the filtrate, it should be evaporated under the reduced pressure, and the residue or mark left behind should be treated with the 1% hydrochloric acid. Now, because of treatment of this 1% hydrochloric acid, it is converting into the salt form. Okay, now this acidic fraction obtained by this way is treated with the petroleum ether, and to remove the impurities like resinous matter and coloring matter. Okay, now this acidic fraction obtained by this way treated with the petroleum ether to remove the impurities. Now, because it is the in salt form and salt is soluble in the non-polar solvent. Okay, it is just opposite in case of free base and in salt form, and salt forms are soluble in the non-polar solvent. That's why in this way the salt, after treatment with the hydrochloric acid, so salt we obtained, and now this salt can be treated with the petroleum ether, and petroleum ether is the non-polar solvent, due to which the impurities, resinous matters and coloring matters will be removed. Then the acid fraction is made alkaline with the ammonia, due to which precipitates of free base is obtained. Now again, when it is converted into the free base, so for free base we will use the non-polar solvent for the extraction. That's why we are taking the chloroform for the extractions of the atropine here. Now, this chloroform fraction is partitioned with the oxalic acid to form the salt of atropine and hyoscyamine. Okay, when you are doing the extractions with the chloroforms, that procedure, this step with the treatment with the chloroform, or we can say the extractions method with the chloroform, should be repeated at least 3 times. It means first extractions you will do, after that whatever the filtrate you are getting, now filtrate you are getting, you will evaporate the solvent and you will keep aside that fraction. Then whatever the precipitate has been remain above the that funnel, so you again add some volume of chloroform again and again, extract with the chloroform and repeat this process at least for the 3 times, and after that you will combine all the chloroform extract. Then you have to evaporate all the chloroform, and then you have to partition with the oxalic acid, so due to which there will be the formations of the atropine and hyoscyamine, and further separations can be carried out by the fractional crystallizations from the acetone and ether. So these are the two common methods which are commonly used for the isolation of the atropine. And here one thing is that suppose somebody is asking to you that what is the industrial method and what is the lab method, so please don't confuse between these two methods. Basic principle will be same, and in industry as well as in lab both methods are same, but the difference is that in industry they produce in the large amount, whereas in our lab we produce in the small quantity. So basic principle will be same. You can apply these methods anytime, anywhere, either it is laboratory or in the industries, and in such a manner whatever the atropine you are getting, so you can identify with the help of some chemical tests. So first test is the Vitali-Morin test, in which you will take the small quantity of the solid atropine. So what you have to do, that you have to take the some crystals of atropine to which you have to add 2 drops of concentrate nitric acid in an evaporating dish and evaporate to dryness on the water bath. Okay, आप क्या कर रहे हैं कि आपने क्रिस्टल्स ऑफ एट्रोपिन लिया, उसमें आपने फ्यू ड्रॉप्स आपने नाइट्रिक एसिड का डाल दिया, इवेपोरेटिंग डिस में करना है, उसके बाद आप इसको नाइट्रिक एसिड इवेपोरेट करेंगे ऑन द वाटर बाथ फॉलोड बाय डिजॉल्विंग द रेसिड्यू. नाउ वट एवर द रेसिड्यू यू आर गेटिंग हेयर यू विल डिजॉल्व इन द 1 ml ऑफ द एसीटोन, एंड आफ्टर दैट यू विल एड फ्यू ड्रॉप्स ऑफ द फ्रेशली प्रिपेयर्ड एल्कोहलिक पोटेशियम हाइड्रोक्साइड सॉल्यूशन to this mixture, due to which you will get the purple color. Next test is Rur-Hanasicum test. So in this test what you will do, that you will take the sample and you will treat with the nitric acid and you will boil for the 10 minutes. Okay, what you are doing, that you have to take the small quantity of the sample and to which you will add the nitric acid followed by the boiling for the 10 minutes. Then after boiling you have to add a small quantity of water followed by the extractions with the chloroform and then filtrations. Okay, आपने क्या किया कि सैंपल लिया, उसमें आपने नाइट्रिक एसिड डाला और उसको आपने बॉयल किया 10 मिनट के लिए. 10 मिनट बॉयल करने के बाद आप उसमें स्मॉल क्वांटिटी वाटर डालेंगे, फिर आप उसको क्लोरोफॉर्म के साथ एक्सट्रैक्ट करते हैं फॉलोड बाय द फिल्ट्रेशन. सो व्हेन यू विल फिल्टर, सो वट एवर द फिल्ट्रेट यू आर गेटिंग, सो after evaporations whatever the residue is left there, at that residue you will add the few drops of the ammonia and again extract with the chloroform. Then the chloroform again is evaporate and residue should dissolve in acetone followed by the addition of the 10% sodium hydroxide, so bluish purple color is obtained. So it was all about the Rur-Hanasicum test, which is used to identify the atropine which you isolate either in your lab or in industry. Next test is Stier test. So in this Stier's test you will take the small quantity of sample to which you will add mixture of freshly prepared solutions of 1 volume of 30% hydrogen peroxide and 10 volumes of the sulfuric acid. So because of this reactions you will get the green color. Okay, so these all are the chemical tests by which we can identify the atropine. Now this atropine can be identified with the help of the chromatography. So you have to prepare, you have to perform the TLC, that is thin layer chromatography. So for the TLC of atropine or for your isolated phytoconstituent, you will use the mobile phase, that is toluene, ethyl acetate, diethyl amine, and the ratio should be 70:10:10. Okay, so you have to take 70 ml of toluene, 20% of ethyl acetate, and 10 ml of, yeah, or we can say 20% of diethyl amine. Okay, so toluene, ethyl acetate, diethyl amine, the ratio you have to take 70:20:10. Whatever the quantity, whatever the volume you are making, that depend, but you have to follow the this ratio pattern for the mobile phase, that is toluene, ethyl acetate, and diethyl amine. And stationary phase will be silica gel G, and detecting agent will be dragon dwarf reagent, which will give the yellow orange color spot. Now what you have to do, that when you are performing that thin layer chromatography, you have to take the standard drug. That standard drug is the atropine, and you have to compare the RF value of that phytoconstituent isolated by the U, that is atropine isolated either in laboratory or industry, with the standard atropine. Okay, that by comparing the RF value, you can confirm the identifications of isolated atropine. And in case of standard atropine, standard RF value, ideal RF value of the atropine is the 0.70. So by comparing this value with this value, by comparing with this value, you can identify the isolated atropine. Now how can we estimate the atropine? So in first method, we will take the plant material which should be extracted with the ethyl ether. Okay, first of all, we will take the plant material and we will extract with the ethyl ether, followed by the partition with the 0.5 normal sulfuric acid. आप क्या कर रहे हैं कि आप पहले ethyl ether के साथ plant material जो आपका powder form में है उसको extract करेंगे, और उसके बाद आप इसका partition करते हैं with the 0.5 normal sulfuric acid के साथ. Okay, we are taking the plant material in the powder form and we will extract with the ethyl ether, followed by partition with the 0.5 normal sulfuric acid. After that, the acidic residue is made alkaline with the ammonia, followed by the extractions with the chloroform. So whatever the acidic residue is obtained there, so it should be treated with the ammonia, and after that we have to do the extractions with the chloroform. Now this chloroform fraction after evaporations of solvent and drying used for the estimations of the alkaloid. So whatever the solvent is there in the extract, we have to evaporate with the help of the distillation, and the residue get behind the extract should be dried, and after drying it should be used for the estimations of the alkaloid. Now this dried chloroform fraction, to the dried chloroform fractions we should add excess quantity of the standardized sulfuric acid. Okay, now what we are doing, that we have to take this dried chloroform extract and we will add excess quantity of standardized sulfuric acid, due to which there will be formations of sulfate salt with the atropine alkaloid. So in the chloroform extract there is the presence of atropine, and now when you are treating with the sulfuric acid, there will be the formations of the atropine sulfate. Now after this, whatever the remaining amount of untreated sulfuric acid is there, okay, when you are using excess amount of sulfuric acid for the treatment with the chloroform extract, so some of the volume of sulfuric acid will react with the chloroform extracts, whereas some will remain as such and it will not react with the sulfuric acid. So what we will do for this untreated sulfuric acid, so this amount of untreated sulfuric acid is determined by the titrations with the standardized alkali. It means we have to perform the acid base titration to find out the untreated sulfuric acids present in the extract बाय द टाइट्रेशंस विद द स्टैंडर्डाइज्ड एल्कली। एल्कली आपका क्या हो सकता है, सोडियम हाइड्रोक्साइड के साथ आप इसकी टाइट्रेशन कर सकते हैं। दैट एसिड बेस्ड टाइट्रेशंस यू हैव टू परफॉर्म टू फाइंड आउट द अनट्रीटेड सल्फ्यूरिक एसिड, एंड इफ यू फाइंड आउट द अनट्रीटेड सल्फ्यूरिक एसिड फ्रॉम दिस वैल्यू यू कैन फाइंड आल्सो द रिएक्टेड सल्फ्यूरिक एसिड with the chloroform extract. So amount of total alkaloid can be calculated from the molar quantity of acid that is reacted with the alkaloid to form the salt. Okay, so whatever the quantity of alkaloid is there, we can calculate from the molar quantity of acid which is reacted with the alkaloid to form the salt. How much quantity of sulfuric acid has been reacted with the extract to form the atropine sulfate, that can be calculated by the molar quantity of the reacted sulfuric acid. So the basic principle for the estimations of atropine by this method is that chloroform fraction contain the definite amount of alkaloids which forms the salt with the specific molar amount of sulfuric acid. So it is the base, or can we can say the principle or basic concept for the estimations by this method. And this method has been described by the United States Pharmacopoeia USP for the belladonna leaf. So it was all about this method. Now the next method is the assay method. So we can perform the assay of atropine sulfate. Okay, so whatever the atropine content is present in the salt, we can determine with the help of the titrimetric method. Okay, with the help of titrations, we can estimate atropine content which is present in the salt. So what we have to do, that we will take the salt, required quantity, required exact weight quantity of the sulfate salt, or we can say that the test fraction, and we will dissolve this sulfate salt in 50 ml of glacial acetic acid followed by titration with the 0.1 normal perchloric acid. Okay, what we are doing, that we have to take the required quantity of the sample. That sample will be in the form of the salt, and we will dissolve that sample in the 50 ml of the glacial acetic acid. After that, we have to do the titration with the 0.1 normal perchloric acid, and endpoint can be determined potentiometrically. And there should also be blank determinations. Blank determinations means which should be without the extract, and from that value we can calculate the amount of atropine sulfate can be calculated. Okay, and the factors which use for the calculations of atropine content is normally 0.1 normal perchloric acid is equivalent to 0.06770 gram of atropine sulfate. By this titrimetric method you can calculate the atropine content which is present in the sulfate. Okay, now the usage of atropine. So it is atropane alkaloid, commonly used as an antispasmodic, mitriatic, anticholinergic, and atropine, hyoscyamine, and hyoscines are strongly mitriatic. So in eye problems they are commonly used, and if you see that some marketed formulations of atropine, there are atropine eye drops, Etionax injection, atropine eye ointment. So these all the marketed formulations. So it was all about the atropine. So here important things are that you have to remember the source of atropine, then about its chemistry, little bit about the chemistry, and after that you have to see the isolation extractions method, its identification test, its estimations method. So it was all about atropine. So thank you very much for watching the video.